diagram shows a second and the first order phase transition separated at three critical points. At delta over j is, as usual, I'm sloppy with the numerator and denominator. I think it's log 4 divided by 3. And t over j is 1/3. So there is a way of locating the zero temperature phase transition, the one that appears on the horizontal axis at 1/2. You can try yourself. Since temperature is zero, then the free energy is simply energy, no? Because free energy is energy minus temperature times entropy. But if t is zero, there is not this term, there is only energy. So if you compare the ferro and the para state, the ferro state is all ones, okay? And the para state, you get two energies. For the ferro state, delta minus 1/2, and for the ferro state, zero. So, and if you equate the two energies, you get delta equal 1/2, okay? And there is another way of getting the point on the y-axis, which is a usual second-order Curie-Weiss transition for a spin-1 system. And you can obtain it by solving the consistency equation that you see here. So it's instead of having to solve tanh of beta x, beta m equal m, you have to solve this consistency equation, which is very similar to the one. And it gives a second order phase transition at the point on the y-axis, okay? So this is our way so for locating the transition at zero temperature and the transition on the y-axis. In the middle, what you have to do for the critical line, you have to expand the free energy in M and in Q, of course, at small m and q, and you have to see where the square term in the development changes sign. And this is the critical point, okay? So, which corresponds, these are trivialities for those who know the problem, but I just, to be clear, I draw the curve, so the free energy will be flat here and will develop a minimum around m equals zero for the, so it's a sign of it's a sign change in df, d2f, dm2. Okay, the derivative of the free energy with respect to the Landau order parameter. So if there is a sign change, then you locate the critical point and you get the line, the critical line, that is shown, second order line, which can be obtained analytically. Yeah? You just develop the free energy in M and you get analytically for the coefficient, and then you look where the coefficient is zero and you get the line, okay? For the first order, it's more complicated because what happens is different. So you know that at first order phase transition, a minimum first appears far from, there is a symmetry. So m minus m, here is m, this is m axis, and there is a symmetry m minus m. And above the phase transition point, you have extra minima that are metastable, okay? And then if you go down in temperature, if you go down in temperature, these two minima go down. And at some point, they will be at the same height as the minimum in zero. And that's the first order phase transition point. And if you go even lower temperature, this will become metastable, the minimum in zero. And the two other will become stable. Okay, in this way you locate the first order phase transition line. Unfortunately, this can be done only numerically because And there is a limiting point between this and this. And that's a point where the fourth order derivative of M is zero. And this is called the tricritical point. So the sixth order is positive and the fourth order is zero. So for the tricritical point, you have to have both the second derivative of the free energy zero and the fourth derivative of the free energy as a function of M, the Landau order parameter, equal to zero. And the sixth order is positive because otherwise the free energy is unbounded, okay? So you want to be bounded to the... Okay. All this would take time. I don't want to spend time in the standard part, which is solution of this model in the canonical ensemble, which was done long ago in the 70s. Okay? So, but now I go to the solution in the microcanonical ensemble. So here there is the exact free energy for this model, and you see the second order phase transition, as I've shown with the two minima, lateral minima in X, and the first order phase transition. This is the point of where the first order phase transition occurs. Okay, these are the two cases. And in the middle, you have a situation where the fourth order derivative is a zero. Okay, so let's go to the microcanonical, which is the where Kelson 1 would say I should not go, but because it's not straightforward. It's not straightforward, but it's not too complicated in this case because it's a mean field model. So let's draw a configuration. And the typical configuration will be a string of pluses, a string of minuses, and a string of zeros. So this is a typical configuration. And since the interaction is mean field, if I swap the pluses, the minuses, and the zeros, I don't change the energy. So for a given energy, so with short range is a problem to swap. But with long range, you don't change the energy. Okay? So the energy is fixed once you fix the number of pluses, the number of minuses, and the numbers of zeros. So how do you count in this case? You just swap all the spins, and this is the n factorial. And then you get the same state if you interchange the pluses, the minuses, and the zeros. So this is the volume of this model, okay, the Boltzmann factor. Let's call omega, which Boltzmann called it W instead of omega, okay? And I don't know, I was trying to write W on a board yesterday and came out omega. And that's because that's a Greek symbol on the... Omega is the Greek symbol on the board of the computer. So you get omega if you press W in the board. Check. So it's the same, omega and W. It's on the grave of Boltzmann in Vienna. There is K log W without B in the constant, because of course we call it Boltzmann constant, but he has no B in the grave. Okay, so this is the Boltzmann constant. So then what you do, did you understand this counting? It's the same counting that you do for the Ising model. For the Ising model, you don't have the zeros, okay? Try to repeat it for the Ising model. For the Ising model, you say, okay, the mean field Curie-Weiss model, I get a different state by swapping the spins, and then I get the same state if I swap the pluses and the minuses. So I have to divide by the interchange of pluses and minuses, and I get the volume for the free, for the mean field Kurivais model that you find in books of statistical mechanics. So what I'm doing, I'm just taking the same for and oh, the disappeared. Oh, maybe. Ah, disaster. The I need power. Ah, ok.
Quindi se riesce a finire per le 12:40.
Sì, sì, sì. Okay. So maybe since I have this limit, instead of waiting for my computer to restart, which will take time, I might give a solution to the exercise, one of the solutions to the exercise, to yesterday's exercise, okay? So do you agree? I will devote 20 minutes to the solution of okay, so tomorrow we will see the phase diagram of, so this obliges, ah, it's back. Okay, I don't know. It's back, but intermittently back. I don't know why. Okay, but it's a, I think it's a good point, because in this way you will have time to look into the solution in the microcanonical ensemble, and in the canonical ensemble you will begin to think of the proposal that I gave you for the okay, let us solve the exercise. Okay. So I will have to compute. I will do it with different variables in such a way that you will see the role of number of particles, because in the perfect gas it's easy. So, this is something you find in the book of Wang, but it doesn't do the Legendre. Don't know why it could have done, but okay. So this is the formula for. So I will spend some time for. So perfect gas. And this is a formula for the volume. The volume. So I have the energy surface. Okay, so the Hamiltonian is the one of the perfect gas. So it's a sum over pi square, pi is vector, over 2m, okay, plus the potential. And the potential is infinite if you are outside of the gas, of the volume is here. So, and the potential here is infinite, and here is zero, okay? Because if you are inside the volume, the potential is zero. If you are outside, the volume is infinite. It's a perfect wall, okay? The gas will be obliged to stay inside. And then what you do, you estimate the states with energy H below E, okay? So this is one type of entropy. You get similar, so what I propose if you try also with the entropy defined on the surface, okay? It will give you similar results. Okay, so then omega, the volume, which is the number of states with H less than E, at fixed V and fixed N, has this formula, omega of E, V and N is K, I will tell you what is K, to 3N over 2, the correct Gibbs factor, N factorial times gamma of 1 plus 3N over 2. If you want, I can derive this, but okay, you find it in books. But if you have troubles, I derived it last night before going to sleep. Then V to the N and E to the 3N over 2. This is the volume in... Okay. The partition sum... So this is the number of states with H less than E. KB is 1. And S of E, V, and N is log of omega. So Boltzmann was using log base 10 and... And omega was W, okay, don't worry. So it's the same. And then the partition sum, what is K? K is 2m pi over h square. H square is not the Planck constant. Omega is dimensional because omega formally is integral dp dq 1, okay, there are three components, okay? dqn, dp1, dpn, delta of, theta of E minus H, okay? This is omega. So it's dimensional, you see? Is dimensional because it's PQ. Okay, and PQ has the H as dimension PQ. Okay? In order to make omega a dimensional, and so it's inside the logarithm, so it should be a dimensional. Okay? Should be dimensionless omega. That is H. And then in quantum mechanics, it is naturally. The Planck constant. That's why it's called H. And what is Z? Z of beta V and N is K to the 3N over 2 over N factorial V to the N. This is much simpler to compute, even for the perfect gas. There's a minus here. Minus 3n over 2, okay? Okay, this is the setting. So now, where did I... Okay, to solve Z, you just... So let us do it now. On the extensive variable, I did it. I don't know why I used the other definition of the Laplace transform, of the Legendre transform. So log of omega minus beta e. Okay, this is the Laplace transform of the entropy. Is the Laplace? The Legendre transform. The Legendre transform of the entropy is the sup over log omega minus beta e. Is the other version and with extensive variables. Don't worry. Okay, so now we want to prove that we will see that the two are different. So if I do this, so to compute the sup. I have to derive with respect to E. So I have 1 over omega. The derivative of omega with respect to E, which is beta, okay? serve to solve this equation. But if I, the omega is this, so all that is a constant. Okay? The only derivative is here with respect to E, and I have to do d omega over omega, so the constant goes away. So what I have 3n over 2 times E to 3n over 2 minus 1 divided E to 3n over 2, which comes from the omega in the denominator, okay? So I can eliminate this, okay? And what I get the equipartition theorem. It's very interesting. I get the equipartition theorem because you see that you get beta equal 3n over 2 E. Okay, so the energy, so if you write in the other way, so the energy of the system will be the number of quadratic terms in the Hamiltonian. Okay, the number of quadratic terms in the Hamiltonian is 3n, and so you get the equipartition theorem, okay? And it's interesting if you replace this here, no? Because you have to replace the minimum, okay, the soup into here, okay? You will kill the E. You see that you kill the E, and you remain only with constant 3n over 2, okay? And the other will be log of omega. Now, if you write log z and you compare with this, with the Legendre function, so you have to write log z, and you have to compare with this soup, okay? And you get a difference. Where is it? Yes. And the difference, you can check. Let's give a name to this. Let's call it, I don't know, psi. Okay? Psi of beta. Psi of beta. So I'm writing now psi of beta, or yes, okay, psi of beta is a function of beta, v, and n, minus log of z, minus log of z, okay? And what I get is 3n over 2, log 3n over 2 minus 3n over 2 minus log of gamma. This gamma, this is a gamma function, 1 plus 3n over 2. So you see that they are not the same. So the Legendre transform, as I was telling you, there is no dependence here on beta, v, it's only dependence on n, okay? It's only dependence on n, but they are not the same at finite n. So the Legendre transform of the logarithm of omega of the perfect gas is not equal to log of z. There are finite n corrections. But if you use a Stirling formula for the gamma function is a factorial, so you can use the Stirling formula, you can check that in the large n, for n goes to infinity, this goes to zero. Okay, that this difference goes to zero in the large n limit. No, because there is this term here, which is proportional to n.
No, forget about the square root term of the Sydney formula, then I agree this is zero. But if you take into account the square root term of the gamma function, then there is 1/2 log n contribution.
I agree. You mean is?
It's not extensive.
No. But these are. This is finite n. So I have to divide by n then.
Okay.
So all constants.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So this is the first order leading order in n.
Okay.
In the right. Okay.
Yeah.
Then there is a order constant.
Yeah.
Order constant go to zero if you divide by n. And then, but they are constants.
Okay. Yeah.
You agree?
No, well, what I'm saying is that that expression there is proportional to 1/2.
Yeah, okay.
So if you divide by n, it goes to zero.
Okay. There is subleading term log n from Stirling, and I didn't take into account, it was midnight. So I took just the first. It was enough for me to look at the leading term in n, and then I went to bed. Okay. But you are right. Yes, so there is a subleading term in the ceiling formula, and it will go to zero if you divide by n. So you can repeat the calculation. You can repeat the calculation for the skin of the sphere, which is different, has different finite n corrections. The skin is, instead of taking the theta, you take the delta, okay? Which is the derivative of the theta. So you can simply take the theta, as in the one book, and you derive by r, and you get the skin of the hypersphere, no? Of the hypersphere. And you will get different finite n corrections. I didn't check because, again, it was midnight. But you can check. I think it will be different. But the leading order should be the same so that that they cancel if you use the Stirling approximation. I would just like to comment. You will hear lectures by my good friend Angelo Vulpiani in the last week. So there have been a big, big debate in the literature whether we should use the skin or the volume. Of course, if the two goes to infinity, I am not aware how the debate finished, but I know that the discussion was around the fact that if you take the theta, you will never get negative temperature in the infinite volume limit, because of course you are increasing, it's an ever increasing function of E. While if you get the skin, of course, you get the negative temperature. The discussion was, are there or not negative temperature? And I think the conclusion is yes, there are negative temperature, but I don't want to enter in this debate. In the case of the perfect gas, there is no negative temperature. There are negative temperature for the Blume-Capelle model. You will see, okay? But there are negative temperature also for the Curie-Weiss model, because you have... At some point, the entropy will go down. So the temperature will become negative. Question is if you can measure negative temperatures in real systems and so on. But I don't want to enter in that. But I propose you to do the calculation only also for the skin, which is easy to do. Okay? About the other exercise, 3 minutes. So what you have to do to argue for a non-existence of phase transition in one dimension for the Ising model, you have to take a typical configuration, which is pluses and minuses, separated by what are called defects. And you have to try to estimate. So suppose you have dispersed defects in a configuration. Okay, and you should try to argue what's the entropy and what's the energy of the defect. And then you will see that the energy is proportional to the number of defects, which if it is small compared to the number of sites, it will not increase with the sides. While the entropy of such a configuration, you can see it also from the calculation, is proportional to n. So the energy will never be able to compete with entropy. And so the state will remain disordered in one dimension. Then I have another calculation and an exercise that I can propose to you. Suppose I take the Dyson model. Okay? Suppose I take the Dyson model and I take this configuration. This is an interesting calculation. I take and by the way, the proposal is in a paper by Taules. So I take a configuration in which the spins are flipped like this. Okay. I flip some number of spin to the left. Okay, and then I try to compute the change in energy. The change in energy, you will see that is able to compete with the entropy. That's a sign that the Ising model of Dyson is able to give a phase transition in one dimension. Also in the region of weak long-range forces, so in the region of sigma larger than zero. Okay. Yes?
I had a question about this before, because yesterday you said that there's like a dynamic and a static view.
Yes.
But at the end I couldn't see, because normally, well, in this case, it's basically Poirot's argument that we say that it's unstable, because if I flip a spin, it won't be able to...
This is the type of Poirot's argument that indeed fails in two dimensions, because the change in energy is able to compete with entropy. The dynamical argument says that these defects, you can prove that these defects move like random walks. And there is no attraction among the defects. So if you wait long enough, the system will always create defects, and there is no way for the system to build a domain. By the defects will arise because as temperature is finite, there will be flips, okay? Of course, it is not true at zero temperature. At zero temperature, in fact, you can form a large domain, and at zero temperature, domain will be the full size of the system. It's sort of kinetic argument that these defects move like random walks, and they will be free to arise at finite temperature, and they will destroy the order in one dimension. Okay. So this is the dynamical.
So this is a fire alarm. It's a test, but essentially it's a nice point
to stop and to run.